This is the story of a forgotten steeplechaser, well before our time and possibly the greatest of all time. It is impossible to say who was the greatest, some say Arkell, others the great chaser of the 1930s, Golden Miller. All I can do is tell you his story, giving certain facts and quotes from his era. This horse was as tough a warrior as was ever bred for this gritty sport, and his weight carrying record has no equal. Cloister was his name, and jumping was his fame. A magnificent beast, carrying huge weights of nearly 14 stone, in class races and winning with ridiculous ease. I must tell you his story. It's hard to imagine that these fields were once graced by arguably, I am loath to say arguably, the greatest Grand National winner of them all, the Monster Cloister. For the year before Cloister won the National, he came here one April afternoon in 1892 to these Cheshire fields, the scene of Cheshire's sporting highlights of the year. The Tarporley races, set here just off the main Chester to Nantwich Road. This was a popular one day of the year event and brought thousands of racegoers to the nearby Tarporley and Beeston station from the Lancashire and Cheshire towns and villages. That day in 1892, the hugely popular Tarporley Green Open Chase, worth a healthy £410, was won by this great chaser who, despite a crushing 13 stone 3 pounds burden, was made the even money favourite and won easily by 10 lengths in the hands of Bill Dollery. Just 2 days earlier, Cloister had shouldered 13 stones of victory by a distance in the Great Staffordshire Chase at Wolverhampton. These days you will never see a racehorse carry such burdens. Cloister's tale is almost forgotten by all, apart from the racing purist and historians purring over long gone glories. These days, with regard to the National, only Red Rum is remembered by the racing public as the years take our dead, and with them their memories. But long before this great Aintree specialist came along were three mightier warriors, class horses, used to carrying welter hunting ways. These being Golden Miller, Manifesto, and our subject, the now forgotten Cloister. Since its inception in 1839, the National has become the most famous horse race in the world, with its famous fences such as the Chair, Beaches and the Canal Turn. During these years it has produced many famous winners, including Lottery, Manifesto, Tipperary Tim, Golden Miller, Reynoldstown, Foynavon, the nation's favourite Red Rum, and of course our subject Cloister. The fences up to the 1970s were huge and have been lowered considerably to be kinder to jockey and horse over the gruelling 4.5 miles. The maximum weights carried now are less than 12 stone, but in the early years, huge hunting weights of 13 stone plus were the norm for many of the top horses. The most notable successes are that of Cloister, Manifesto, Golden Miller, Reynoldstown and Red Rum. In that Cloister won by a distance carrying a huge weight in record time, Manifesto twice with huge weights, Golden Miller with the Gold Cup and the National in the same year, Reynoldstown won 2 years on the trot, and Red Rum was the triple winner. The forthcoming clip is Red Rum's first win, where he cruelly denied Chris, who had led for most of the way clear, until the 1.5 stone extra weight told on the running.
Crispin, what a fantastic ride he's having. I can't remember a horse so far ahead in the Grand National at this stage.
It was pulsating, exhibition stuff, but Nemesis was stalking.
Crispin's getting very tired, and Red Rum is pounding after him.
Red Rum was almost the villain of the piece that day, as sporting hearts went out to the heroic runner-up, who was trying to give the winner £23.
He's going to get up. Red Rum is going to win the National. And at the line, Red Rum has just snatched it from Chris.
The race smashed the record time that had stood since Gordon Miller's victory in 1934.
Here is a selection of old photographs of Beeston and Tarporley Station, where racecourse from Lancashire and Cheshire towns would arrive at. This station was shut under the beaching regime in the 1960s. There's the old station. To the left was the cattle market. Can you see in the far there? That's the station master's house, which incidentally is still resided in by the last station master's son. There's a photograph of the old cattle market. Now we shall go live. This is all that remains of the old cattle market by the station, as seen in the previous photographs. Just off the busy Whitchurch to Tarporley Road. This is all that remains of the station forecourt, used by locals now as a car park, it seems. In the foreground, we are now approaching the station master's house, which, incidentally, is still resided in by the last station master's son. We are now in the village of Tarporley. This is a high street. Cottages which would have been there in Cloister's day. An elegant townhouse. From another angle, there are many of these on the Tarporley High Street. A beautiful village. There is the rising sun, which would have been frequented by many of the racegoers. And this is that majestic building, the Swan Hotel, the meeting place for the Cheshire Hunt. And it still is. There's a marvellous book called The Green Collars, which I do recommend, which describes the history of the Cheshire hunting scene. And now, coming up on the A51, the Chester to Nantwich Road, we have the entrance to the old Tarporley racecourse. Here it is. The road to Cloister. Let's walk where our long gone friends have trod. Though the course was over natural country, about 2 miles in circumference, the facilities were perfectly acceptable. There was a private stand for Tarporley Hunt Club members and friends, capable of accommodating 500, and a public stand in the paddock which could hold 1500. The majority swamped the inner of the track. Gordon Ferguson writes in The Green Collars, a Cheshire record of hunting, that it was a right-handed circular course, and in time stands were built, behind which was a small railed parade ring with the weighing room and changing room alongside. With its climb up to an exceptionally short running of 200 yards from the last fence, and often tenacious going, Tarporley was considered as good a test as any for a true chaser, and many good horses and great horsemen did battle over the birch and gorse fences on the Cheshire grassland. So, who was Cloister? Cloister was foaled in 1884, a son of a Setic, a previous great champion, and Cloister was his first winner at the Grand National Steeplechase in 1893, when a Setic was 22 years old. Cloister was one of the best steeplechasers of the 19th century and one of the best of all time. His thoroughbred dam, Grace II, had been imported into Ireland from England. Grace II was purchased for use as a hunter by Arthur Plunkett, the 11th Earl of Fingal, whose seat was Killeen Castle at Dunsany in County Meath. She was used as a whipped horse in the hunt field, and according to Fingal's son, the 12th Earl, not over satisfactory in that capacity, as she had no great aptitude for hunting. Indeed, it is said she became a mare on which the postman did his rounds. Grace II was bred when she was 8 to a Setic, the nearest available sire, and dropped Cloister, her first foal, the following year. Cloister was so unimpressive that the Earl sold both him and Grace II to Percy Maynard, master of the Ward Hounds, for a total of 31 guineas. Although she bred over a dozen foals until her death at the age of 26, Cloister was the only one of Grace II youngsters to prove superior. Now back to the racecourse itself. The turnstiles and grandstand, which was situated from where I am stood now, were sold on, and the farming land has since regained its solitude and majestic rural setting. The lines of carriages used for viewing in Cloister's day, and huge parties held on the course and afterwards by the Duke of Westminster at his local estate at nearby Eaton Hall, have long evaporated into time, no more to grace these Cheshire fields. Now back to Cloister. In the 1891-92 season, Cloister reeled off 5 wins, including the Grand Sefton Steeplechase at Liverpool, carrying 12 stone 7 pounds, his last race of the season. He ran in the 1892 Grand National as a favourite, weighted with 12 stone 3 pounds, but ran second, again having been beaten in 1891 by a comeaway. This time, he was 20 lengths behind Father O'Flynn, to whom he conceded almost 2 stone. Soon after his Grand National run, he was sold to Charles Duff and was sent to another brilliant jump jockey, this being Arthur Yates, a highly successful trainer of chasers, whose own horse, Harvester, had almost won the Grand National in 1872, and who had had national winners Gamecock, winner of almost every major steeplechase in England, and Rockfort in his yard at Bishop Sutton, Aylesford, Hampshire. Cloister was the last great chaser Yates trained. In 1893, Cloister came out for the Grand National handicap with a weight of 12 stone 7 pounds, the first time a horse had received such a crushing weight in that race. Piloted by the Bishop Sutton stable jockey, Willem Dollery, who had ridden Cloister in the Grand Sefton the year before, Cloister won the race under a record weight in the record time of 9 minutes 42 seconds, beating the second horse, Aesop, carrying 34 pounds less by 40 lengths. This performance burnished Cloister's reputation as the best chaser of his era and perhaps the best of all time. Cloister prepped well for the 1894 Grand National and was back to odds of 6-4, but the odds went out to 6-1 the same day when he came back from schooling at Sandown slightly lame. Bootmakers knew instantly, arousing great suspicion. After appearing sound for a few days, the lameness attributed to an injury of the sciatic nerve, or possibly something involving his kidneys, returned, and he was withdrawn from the race. After his breakdown, Cloister was moved to the yard of Harry Escott at Lewes in Sussex. In November of 1894, Cloister won the Grand Sefton Steeplechase again at Aintree, easily, carrying the great weight of 13 stone 3, and then won a race at Sandown. In 1895, exactly a year after he fell lame prior to the 1894 Grand National, he collapsed without warning after a mile during a training run on the Sussex Down, and lay still for some time with his tongue hanging out. Once again, the bootmakers knew of it almost instantly. He was withdrawn from the National and did not run that year. The following year, in 1896, he ran in the Welsh Grand National at Cardiff, when more than 40,000 racegoers flocked to Ely Racecourse to see him renew rivalry with the 1892 Grand National winner Father O'Flynn. The legendary Cloister, ridden by Welshman Gwyn Saunder Davies, won in the Common Canter. He also won the Great Shropshire Steeplechase that year at Ludlow, and he was retired to his owner's seat at Vanel, Carnarvonshire in Wales, having won 19 of his 35 races, carrying mostly huge weights, placed second 8 times and third 3 times, unplaced only 5 times in his racing career. He died in January of 1903, aged 19, at Lower Forty Farm, Wembley Park. His head is preserved in the National Horse Racing Museum. That was Cloister, really, apart from many rumours of him being got at prior to subsequent nationals and unable to run. The bookies were in fear of him and collected heavily from losing anti-post bets. Comparing Cloister to later heroes like Arkle and Golden Miller is hard, as these two champions raced in different generations. Both were freaks and well above their contemporaries. The Miller won 5 Gold Cups and the National, Arkle 3 Gold Cups and countless handicaps with top weight. The only modern day chaser to compare due to weight carrying performances would be Denman, who won 1 Gold Cup, placed twice when ill, and won 2 Ennises under top weight. Finally, back to the racecourse itself. If one googles a satellite of the area, one can still make out fine outlines of positions of buildings near the Ashwood area, behind where I am stood now. The water jump was down alongside the A51 road to the left. Nothing tangible remains, no buildings, no memorabilia, only the sandstone pillar. No clues that a racecourse existed. Just the reclaimed eerie countryside for the ghost to wander to, the echo of distant hooves and imaginary crowds of happy days now long gone. This was Tarporley Races. Thank you.